بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلله فلا هادي له. ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له. ونشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله تعالى عليه وعلى آله وصحبه وبارك وسلم تسليما كثيرا كثيرا. أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. اللهم بارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. Respected listeners, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. As was announced, today's talk is about the noble companion Abu Ubaydah ibn al Jarrah radiyallahu anhu. During the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he featured prominently in the public life of the Muslims, and he was very close to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, given positions of authority and trust. Unfortunately, he passed away during the Khilafah of Amir al-Mu'mineen Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu, and there are only a handful of hadith, fewer than 15 hadith related from Sayyidina Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah radiyallahu anhu. As a result of which, both the fewer number of hadith and the fact that he died very early during the Khilafah of Amir al-Mu'mineen Umar ibn al-Khattab, for these reasons and others, not much is known about him, and nor is he as famous as some of the other companions. Even though during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was very prominent and one of the most beloved companions to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So hopefully, inshallah, we will learn a bit more about him and be educated about his life, his character and personality. And the purpose and wisdom of speaking about and learning about the lives of the companions radiyallahu anhum is that we may be inspired and strengthened and motivated to adopt their noble character, to follow in their footsteps, to learn from their example. One of the most famous scholars and saints of this Ummah, Imam Junaid al-Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi, he, whilst speaking to his students, was asked that, is there any benefit in relating the stories and the accounts of the pious people, since it has always been part of learning and Islamic tradition to relate stories of the piety of the ulama and the sulaha, the learned and the pious of the ummah. And in many speeches and lectures and discussions, and in many books as well, you will find many stories and accounts from lives of the ulama and the pious throughout the centuries of the Ummah. So and biographies have always played a great part in Islamic tradition. So is there any purpose, is there any wisdom in relating these stories? As long as, of course, they are authentic. So Imam Junayd al-Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi said, yes, of course there is. These great benefits. So students asked him, that, is there any proof of what you say and contend that there is a great benefit in relating and listening to the stories of the pious? So Imam Junayd al-Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi recited the verse of Surah Hud in the Quran, in which Allah says, addressing the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, وَكُلٌّ نَقُصُّ عَلَيْكَ مِنْ أَنْبَاءِ الرُّسُلِ مَا نُثَبِّتُ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ وَجَاءَكَ فِي هَذِهِ الْحَقُّ وَمَوْعِظَةٌ وَذِكْرَى لِلْمُؤْمِنِينَ. Addressing the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, Allah says, and indeed, we do relate to you of each of the accounts of these messengers, such accounts that through them, or such an account that through it, نُثَبِّتُ بِهِ فُؤَادَكَ, we give steadfastness and strength to your heart. And the truth has come to you in these stories, in these tales of the prophets, and a lesson, a remembrance, and an admonition has come in these accounts of the prophets for the believers. So this was the verse which Junayd al-Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi cited as proof and in substantiation of his argument that relating the stories of the pious has a great purpose and wisdom. And indeed, consider this verse of the Quran. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam was the imam and the leader and the best of all of the prophets of Allah without exception. So he was superior to them. And yet Allah tells him that, O Messenger of Allah, we do relate to you the stories of the prophets to whom you are superior and of whom you are the leader and the chief. And yet in relating the stories of those to whom you are superior and you are the leader, we still grant you steadfastness and the strength of the heart through these stories. And the truth comes to you in these stories. There was solace and there was comfort and consolation for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and lessons for him also. And in another verse of the Quran, after relating the stories of the prophets, alayhim as-salatu wa some of the prophets, and providing an account of some of the messengers, Allah says to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam again, فَبِهُدَاهُ مُقْتَدِهُ, that, O Prophet of Allah, adopt the example and follow in the footsteps of their guidance. So if even the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam is strengthened and inspired, and he is given steadfastness, and the truth comes to him, and a lesson comes to him, and he is instructed to follow in the footsteps of those prophets, alayhim wassalam, whose accounts Allah relates to him in the Quran, then what of us? Wouldn't we be inspired and strengthened and motivated? Wouldn't we be encouraged to gain a lesson and to follow in the footsteps of those who are far superior to us? And so, as Imam Junayd al-Baghdadi rahmatullahi alayhi said, indeed there is a great wisdom and benefit and purpose in relating and listening to the stories of the pious. And for the Muslims of the Ummah, after the messengers of Allah, alayhim as-salatu was-salam, who is regarded as being the best of creation? The companions of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And indeed, after the Prophet of Allah alayhi salatu wasalam, if one just focused on the lives of the companions, years would pass before one would expire their accounts and lessons and morals to be gained from their lives. So it's in this spirit and with this understanding that we speak of the noble companion Abu Ubaydah ibn al Jarrah radiyallahu anhu. Sayyidina Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahmatullahi alayhi relates a hadith in his Musnad from, well, it's actually an athar. It's a saying of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu. And he says very beautifully, it's a very long hadith, and I'll just quote the beginning of it. He says, "Man kana mustannan falyastanna biman qad mat, fa innal hayya la tu'manu alayhi al-fitnah." Whoever is going to follow anyone else's example, then let him follow the example and the sunnah of one who has passed away. Because those who are alive, there is no guarantee that they will not be subjected to trial and tribulation. I.e., as long as anyone is still alive, they can change. From good to bad and bad to good, from better to worse and from worse to better. So there's no guarantee about the scholarship or the piety or the salvation of anyone who's still alive. So if someone, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiyallahu anhu says, if someone is going to follow in the footsteps of another and adopt their example, then let him adopt the example and follow in the tradition and in the footsteps of those who have already passed away. And who was he referring to? He continues, he said, here, these are the messengers, these are the companions of the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wasallam. They were the best of this ummah. With the most profound knowledge, with the least affectation, and pomp, and pretensions. With the most pious and noble of hearts, Allah selected them and chose them for his for the company of his messenger, and in order to establish his religion. So recognize their worth and follow in their and hold on fast to their traditions. For indeed they were upon the straight path. So for the Ummah, after the Prophets of Allah alayhi wasallatu wasalam, there was none other and no one better whose example the Ummah can adopt and in whose footsteps the Ummah can follow than the noble companions of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, of whom Allah has said in the Qur'an, Allah is pleased with them and they are pleased with Allah. And as Allah says, وَالسَّابِقُونَ الْأَوَّلُونَ مِنَ الْمُهَاجِرِينَ وَالْأَنصَارِ الَّذِينَ اتَّبَعُوهُمْ بِإِحْسَانٍ رَضِيَ اللَّهُ عَنْهُمْ وَرَضُوا عَنْهُ. And those who were the first of the Ansar and of the Muhajireen, of the companions from Medina and of the emigrants, and of those who followed them in a good way. So Allah even speaks of those who come later but who follow in the footsteps of the companions, of the Muhajirun and the Ansar. And in fact, in one verse of the Quran, Allah says, "Fa'in in Surah Al-Baqarah, fa'in amanu bimithli ma amantum bih, faqad ihtadaw. وَإِن تَوَلَّوْا فَإِنَّمَا هُمْ فِي شِقَاقٍ." Allah says, addressing the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, around the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that if they, others, if they believe just as you have believed, then indeed they have found guidance. But if they turn away, then indeed they are in differing conflict. So Allah set the iman, the faith, and the practice of the noble companions as a standard by which to judge others. If others believe as the companions believed, then they have found guidance. But if they turn away from the path of the companions, then they are in differing conflict. And in another verse, وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُمُ الْهُدَىٰ وَيَتَّبِعْ غَيْرَ سَبِيلِ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّىٰ وَنُصْلِهِ جَهَنَّمْ وَسَاءَتْ مَصِيرًا. Allah says, and whoever opposes the messenger after guidance has become clear for him, وَمَنْ يُشَاقِقِ الرَّسُولَ مِنْ بَعْدِ مَا تَبَيَّنَ لَهُ الْهُدَىٰ, whoever opposes the messenger after guidance has become clear for him, and he follows a path other than the path of the believers, the mu'mineen, نُوَلِّهِ مَا تَوَلَّىٰ, we will thrust him or turn him. We will turn him and thrust him in the direction which he himself has chosen. So if someone follows a path other than, if someone opposes a messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam and follows a path other than the path of the mu'mineen, Allah says we will turn him and thrust him in the very direction which he has adopted, which is different and in opposition to the direction and the method and the path of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Most importantly, when Allah says mu'mineen here, the believers, he is referring to not the general body of believers that come after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam's time. Of course, in a way that is one consideration of the verse also, but the primary, original meaning and the main consideration of the verse is whoever opposes a messenger and follows a path other than the believers, i.e. the noble companions and the believers around the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So their way, their path, their iman and belief were all a standard by which Allah judged others. So speaking of Abu Ubaydah ibn al Jarrah radiyallahu anhu, his name was Abu Ubaydah, was his kunya, but his name was actually Amir ibn Abdullah, and he was from the Quraysh tribe, from Makkah al-Mukarramah. He was born in Makkah, approximately 13 years younger than the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, one of the very first people to embrace Islam. And in fact, he, according to some narrations, he was one of the first people in that he numbered in the first 10 or 12 who actually embraced Islam, along with, in one narration, a group of them, including Uthman ibn Mud'un, Abdul Rahman ibn Awf, Ubaydah ibn al-Harith, Abu Salamah ibn Abd al-Asad, and Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah radiyallahu anhum. These five companions went and approached the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in Mecca. He explained the tenets of Islam to them and its teachings. They accepted and they embraced Islam at his hands in the very early days of the Prophet's call in Mecca. And ever since he embraced, he clung on to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with the love, devotion and dedication. In the fifth year of prophethood approximately, when the persecution of Muslims in Mecca was on the rise and the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam advised the believers to emigrate, those of them who could, to Abyssinia and seek refuge there with the Christian king Najashi, was a just king. One of those who emigrated was Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah radiyallahu anhu. He didn't stay there for long and he returned. He then did hijrah with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to Medina, and from the very beginning he participated in all of the battles along with the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And not only that, but because of the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam viewed him and trusted him, and he actually loved him dearly, he appointed him as the leader of many military expeditions. And in the Battle of Badr, Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah radiyallahu anhu was at the forefront. And one real test of his love for Allah and his Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam and his devotion and dedication to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam was when he was actually faced in the Battle of Badr by his own father. His father was was in the pagan camp of Mecca, and the son Abu Ubaydah was with the Muslims. Abu Ubaydah initially avoided the father, but the father, in order to provoke his son, kept on coming in front of him. Eventually, they fought, and Abu Ubaydah killed his own father. There were other companions who also had to face their own family members, and a number of authors of hadith, including Imam Tabarani and Imam Bayhaqi in his Sunan and others, relate that when these companions, and specifically when these companions faced members of their family in the Battle of Badr, and specifically Abu Ubaydah ibn al Jarrah radiallahu anhu, who unfortunately ended up fighting with his own father, Allah Azza wa Jal revealed the verse of Surah Al-Mujadala, in which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَا تَجِدُ قَوْمٍ يُؤْمِنُونَ بِاللَّهِ وَالْيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ يُوَادُّونَ مَنْ حَادَّ اللَّهُ وَرَسُولَهُ وَلَوْ كَانُوا آبَاءَهُمْ أَوْ أَبْنَاءَهُمْ أَوْ إِخْوَانَهُمْ أَوْ عَشِيرَتَهُمْ أُولَئِكَ كَتَبَ فِي قُلُوبِهِمُ الْإِيمَانِ وَأَيَّدَهُمْ بِرُوحٍ مِّنْهِ وَيُدْخِلُهُمْ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارُ خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا أُولَئِكَ حِزْبُ اللَّهِ أَلَا إِنَّ حِزْبَ اللَّهِ هُمُ الْمُفْلِحُونَ رضي الله عنهم ورضوا عنه أولئك حزب الله ألا إن حزب الله هم المفلحون. Allah says, you will not find a people who believe in Allah and in the final day, befriending and loving those who have challenged Allah and His Messenger, even though these challenges may be their own fathers, or their own sons, or their own brothers, or their own families. These are a people in whose hearts Allah has engraved iman, faith, and Allah has strengthened and supported them with a spirit from unto Himself. And Allah will enter them into gardens beneath which rivers shall flow. Allah is pleased with them, they are pleased with Allah. This is a party of Allah, and lo, indeed the party of Allah is the one which is victorious. Now, do remember that these verses were revealed specifically about the noble companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam after the Battle of Badr, because of their unique situation. So the verse should be understood in that context. But this is a hadith related by Imam Tabarani and Imam Bayhaqi and other authors of hadith, Ibn Abi Hatim, as well as others. And it shows Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah radiyallahu an in his loyalty, dedication, and devotion to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. After the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam left this world, Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah radiyallahu anhu was just as highly regarded by the companions as he was by the Messenger of Allah. And how was he regarded by the Messenger of Allah? In a hadith related by Imam Tirmidhi in his Sunan, Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentioned a number of companions, and of each of them he said how great and beautiful a man is, and amongst them he mentioned Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah. Ni'm al-Rajul, Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah. How great and beautiful a man is Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah. And in fact, in one narration related by Ibn Asākir and others, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam addressed his own companions. Imagine such a testimony on the part of the Messenger of Allah. And he was speaking to the companions, and he said to them, there is not one person amongst you except that if I wished, I could seize him for some fault in his character. There is not one person amongst you except that if I wish, I could seize him and hold him to account for some fault in his character, except Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah. And the same hadith has been narrated by Ibn Abu Bakr ibn Abi Shaybah in his Al-Musannaf, and by others also. But the wording is slightly different. Instead of addressing the companions, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "There is no one amongst my companions who, if I wish, I would not be able to seize them for some flaw in their character. I.e., everyone has a flaw in their character that I could hold them to account for, with the exception of Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah." But the hadith is mursal, for those of you who know the difference, related by Al-Hasan al-Basri, who's not one of the companions. And most famously, Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah radiyallahu anhu is one of the 10 promised Jannah. He is from the Al-Asharat al-Mubashara. And again, Imam Tirmidhi rahmatullahi alayhi relates a very beautiful hadith from the noble companion Sa'id ibn Zayd radiyallahu anhu, who said to his students that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said there are 10 people in Jannah. Abu Bakr is in Jannah. Umar is in Jannah. Uthman is in Jannah. Ali is in Jannah. Talha is in Jannah. Zubayr is in Jannah. Abdul Rahman ibn Auf is in Jannah. Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah is in Jannah. Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas is in Jannah. Then Sa'id ibn Zayd radiyallahu anhu fell silent. So these were only 9. So his student said to him, "O Abu al-A'war," again this was a kunya of Sa'id ibn Zayd radiyallahu anhu, "O Abu al-A'war, who is the 10th? So Sa'id ibn Zayd radiyallahu anhu remained silent. So the students pressed him and said, "O Abu al-A'war, we beseech, we ask of you in the name of Allah, through the name of Allah, we ask of you that you tell us who is the 10th person of whom the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said he is in Jannah." So Sa'id ibn Zayd radiyallahu anhu said, "Now that you ask me, pressing me in the name of Allah, then I must say that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, and Sa'id is in Jannah," referring to himself. This was his humility. He would not mention the fact that he was included amongst the 10 promised Jannah by Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. The Sahaba radiyallahu anhum were remarkable in their self-effacement, in their humility. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam not only praised Abu Ubaydah radiyallahu anhu, but he loved him dearly. And he must have had some truly profound and endearing qualities for which the Messenger of Allah loved him thus. Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, rahmatullahi alayhi, relates a hadith in his Musnad from Abdullah ibn Shaqiq, who says that, "I asked Ummul Mu'mineen Aisha radiyallahu anha," there were others also, he said, "I asked Umm al-Mu'mineen Aisha radiyallahu anha, that of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who was the most beloved to the Messenger of Allah, of the companions?" So Aisha radiyallahu anha said, "Abu Bakr was the most beloved of the companions to the Messenger of Allah." We then asked, "Then who?" Umm al-Mu'mineen Aisha radiyallahu anha said, "Then Umar." We then asked, "Then who?" Umm al-Mu'mineen Aisha radiyallahu anha said, "Who?" After Abu Bakr and Umar, Umm al-Mu'mineen Aisha said, "Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah." He was the third person in line whom the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam loved the most of the companions. Of the companions. After Abu Bakr and Umar, Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah. Then Yazid, one of those who was present, asked her, "Then who?" Umm al-Mu'mineen Aisha radiyallahu anha remained silent. She only mentioned 3 people: Abu Bakr, Umar, and Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah radiyallahu anha. Why wouldn't the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam love him? He when he was devoted to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in such a way that Sayyidina Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu relates this account, that in the Battle of Uhud, which took place in the third year of Hijrah, 1 year after the Battle of Badr. As you know, in the Battle of Uhud, the Muslims scored a victory initially. However, because of the failure of a group of archers to obey the command of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam not to leave their posts on a small hillock overlooking a ravine, which was strategically very important to the Muslims, and if that remained exposed, then the Quraysh would have been able to attack the Muslims from the rear. So because of the failure of these archers to obey the command of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Muslims suffered a great setback. They initially scored a great victory, the Quraysh were in retreat and were dispersing. However, it was Allah's wisdom that Khalid ibn al-Walid radiyallahu anhu was waiting with a 200 force of cavalry at a distance. And he, being the general that he was, he was specifically observing this particular post of the archers and this hillock overlooking the ravine. And when the Muslims thought that the Quraysh had fled the battlefield and now the battle was over, and some of the companions on the hillock decided to abandon their positions and come down into the battlefield, main battlefield, contrary to the instructions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, only a handful were left. And when Khalid ibn al-Walid saw this, he then attacked the Muslims from the rear with his cavalry, and word was sent to the retreating Quraysh to return and attack the Muslims from the front. So the Muslims were caught in a pincer movement, as a result of which they suffered a huge setback, and many companions were martyred, many were injured, so much so that even the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was injured. And Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as a strategic maneuver, he retreated to the safety of the mountain with just a handful of companions around him. And in that confusion, he was also attacked. One of the Quraysh came and attacked him. Luckily, though, he was only able to strike the helmet. But it was with such force that the helmet of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the rings of the helmet and the links embedded themselves in the noble cheeks of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Abu Bakr radiyallahu anhu relates that I rushed to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and as I was rushing towards him, I saw someone coming from the east as though he was flying, meaning he was rushing and hurrying to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam with such haste and speed that it seemed as though he was flying. It's just a metaphoric term. I saw someone coming from the east as though he was flying, and when I saw him coming, I pray to Allah that, O Allah, make this a coming of obedience, i.e. make him someone who is one of the companions of the Messenger, who comes to defend the Messenger and let him not be one of the enemy. And I rushed to the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and we both met, and lo and behold, it was none other than Abu Ubaydah ibn al Jarrah. I rushed forward to try and remove the links from the cheeks of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, but Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah beat me to it, and he said, "Leave me be." Then, because the links were embedded with such force that the links were embedded very deeply, they could not be removed normally. So Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah radiyallahu anhu clasped one of the links with his teeth, and with great vigor and force he bit it and tried to pull it from the cheek of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he was able to. But in the process, the link came out, one of the teeth of Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah fell out, and because he pulled with such force, he actually fell back and landed on his back. Then he rose and bit the other link, and again with great force he pulled the link out with his teeth, he lost another tooth. Abu Ubaydah ibn al Jarrah radiallahu anhu lost two teeth from the front, but it was something which he prided himself on for the rest of his days, and which the companions loved him for. And his appearance was such that he was very tall, slim, lean of face, lean of body. He had a very sparse beard, and his two teeth were missing. But the companions would say that we have never seen any gap in anyone's teeth as beautiful as a gap in the teeth of Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah. Not only was it beautiful, but it reminded them of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. In fact, when Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah radiyallahu anhu, as I said, he was tall, very slim, lean of body, lean of face, sparse beard, and he would actually dye his hair and his beard with henna. And when he died, he had two plaits. This is something which many people find surprising. But plaits for men are permissible. And Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah radiyallahu anhu, he was, when he died, he had two plaits. Unless anyone thinks that that's not very manly, he was the supreme commander of the Rashidun army in Syria. He was the supreme commander. But he had two plaits. Khayran. So Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah radiyallahu anhu, that's how he lost his teeth. That was his love for Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wasallam loved him as dearly. Not only did he love him, not only did he regard him highly, but one of the most important things is he trusted him. He trusted him in such a way that Sayyidina Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu relates in a hadith recorded by Imam Bukhari in his Sahih and by others, that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam publicly announced, إِنَّ لِكُلِّ أُمَّةٍ أَمِينَ وَإِنَّ أَمِينَنَا أَيَّتُهَا الْأُمَّةِ أَبُو عُبَيْدَةَ بْنُ الْجَرَّاحِ. That indeed every nation has a trustee. And the trustee, and our trustee, our Ummah, is Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah. And the occasion when he said this was when in the 9th year of Hijrah, some of the Christian leaders from Najran, which today is part of Arabia, and then as well in the south of Arabia, then it was a famous Christian stronghold. So, and virtually most of the tribes in that whole region were Christian tribes. So, and it's part of southern Arabia. So a delegation, a very large delegation of their leaders came to Medina in the 9th year of Hijrah. And they had discussions with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in Masjid al-Nabi sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he invited them to Islam, but they did not accept. Eventually, they came to an agreement. They accepted the authority of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, though not his religion. And as part of that agreement, they were to pay a tribute to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the Muslims. So these leaders of Najran said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, please send with us someone who is trustworthy. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, it's a hadith later by Imam Bukhari, I will send with you someone who is trustworthy, حق الأمين, truly trustworthy. And in one narration of the same hadith, recorded by Imam Ahmed in his Musnad and others, Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I will send with you someone who is trustworthy, trustworthy, trustworthy. The narrator says the companions, in order to gain this honor and win this title of being trustworthy, they all sat up and leant forward on their knees, raising their heads in the hope that they would be selected. Even someone like Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu, he says, in my entire life, I have never aspired to leadership except on that one day when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam announced that he will send a trustworthy person with the delegation of Najran. He said, on that day, I actually raised my head also, hoping to be selected by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, and that's one occasion when I did aspire to leadership and selection. But despite everyone's aspirations and hopes, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam pointed to Abu Ubaydah ibn al Jarrah and said, "Oh Abu Ubaydah, rise." And he took his hand and said to the delegation of Najran, "He is a trustee of my ummah." So, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam trusted him to that degree. He had some truly amazing qualities. It's unfortunate that we don't know more about him, but it's the qadr of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But do remember, it's not always those that we know the most about that are the best. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu has very few narrations of hadith in contrast to the other companions. Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah radiyallahu anhu also has very few narrations of hadith, fewer than 15. Compared to the other companions. And yet, they were of the best of this ummah. To such a degree that after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam passed away, Imam Muslim rahmatullahi alayhi relates a hadith in his sahih, again from Umm al-Mu'mineen Aisha radiyallahu anha, that she was asked that if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have named a successor, who would he have named specifically? So Umm al-Mu'mineen Aisha radiyallahu anha said Abu Bakr. Then she said Umar. Then she said Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah. So it's a very similar hadith to the one I quoted earlier. That's a hadith of Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal in his Musnad, in which Abdullah ibn Shaqiq and Yazid and others asked Umm al-Mu'mineen Aisha radiyallahu anha about who was the most beloved to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam from amongst his companions. And she replied, these three in the same order, Abu Bakr, Umar and Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah. And this hadith of Sahih Muslim, and recorded by Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal in his Musnad also, and by others, is a very similar hadith from Umm al-Mu'mineen Aisha radiyallahu anha, but not about who was the most beloved. But the question was, if the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would have specifically appointed someone and named someone as his successor, who would he have named? So Abu Bakr, then Umar, then Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah. And indeed, immediately after the passing away of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in the Saqifa of Banu Sa'idah, when the Muslims gathered, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu stood up. And even though he was appointed by the Muslims as the Khalifa and the successor to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, who did he recommend? He rose and, addressing the congregation, he said to them, "O people, I am content and pleased with one of two people to be your leader. And the two are Umar ibn al-Khattab and Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah." Even though Abu Ubaydah radiyallahu anhu was 10 years younger than him, he was 10 years younger than Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu, and yet he said, I am content and pleased with one of these two men to serve as your leader, O Muslims, either Umar ibn al-Khattab or Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah. Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu, he himself on that occasion, he said to Abu Ubaidah, Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal relates in his Musnad, another beautiful hadith, says that on that occasion, Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu said to Abu Ubaidah, "O Abu Ubaidah, extend your hand so that I may pledge my allegiance to you. For indeed, I have heard the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam say that you are the Amin and the trustee of this ummah." So Abu Ubaydah radiyallahu anhu's reply was, I will never allow myself to be placed before someone whom the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam instructed to lead us in prayer in his presence, and who continued to lead us in prayer until the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam passed away, meaning Abu Bakr radiyallahu anhu. So eventually when Abu Bakr Siddiq radiyallahu anhu was appointed, he appointed Abu Ubaydah ibn al Jarrah, being the Amin and the trustee of the Ummah, as the treasurer. And when Abu Bakr Siddiq radiyallahu anhu passed away and Umar ibn Khattab radiyallahu anhu became the Khalifa, he was named by Abu Bakr Siddiq radiyallahu anhu. Then Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiyallahu anhu continued with his friendship and his trust of Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah. In fact, Sayyidina Umar radiyallahu anhu loved him. Not only loved him, but respected him, and he considered him a brother and a friend. He praised him. Imagine someone of the caliber of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu saying the following. Once he was seated with a group of people, and he said to them, wish. These were his companions. These were the normal people of his gathering, his friends, his closest advisors. And he said to them, wish. So they all wished. Someone wished for one thing, another wished for something else. After they had finished expressing their wishes as to what they would really want, Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu said, do you know what I wish for? I wish for a house full of people like Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah. That's what I wish for. He admired him and trusted him to such a degree that he wished for a house full of people like Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah. And he trusted him, for indeed he had heard the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam say he is a trustee of this ummah. He appointed him as the commander of the forces in Sham, in Syria. And he actually relegated Khalid ibn al-Walid radiyallahu anhu from command, overall command. And he made Sayyidina Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah the supreme commander of all the Muslim forces in Sham, modern day Syria, Jordan, the Levant, and even southern Turkey, that whole region. And Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah radiyallahu anhu was then responsible for conquering the whole region all the way to the Euphrates River in the east and all the way to Antioch and the borders of Asia Minor in the north. Unfortunately, in the 18th year of Hijrah, a plague struck the Muslims in that region. It was a severe plague. Many, many Muslims died. When Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu heard of this plague, one of the first things he did was he tried to summon Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah from Sham, where he was based. And in fact, in one narration it says, well, he tried to summon Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah and he sent him a letter. And in the letter he said to him, O Abu Ubaydah, a need has arisen here, and I cannot remain independent of you. I am in need of you. So make haste and return to me immediately. Unfortunately, when Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah received that letter, he had already contracted the illness and he was already suffering from the plague. He wrote back. And when he received the letter, he said to his companions, he said, I know what Amir al-Mu'mineen wants of me. I know what his need is. What was the need of Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu? Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu wanted to ensure that if he could save anyone, it would be Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah. So Abu Ubaydah radiallahu anhu said, I know what Amir al-Mu'mineen wants of me and what his need is. His need is, and his desire is, that he wishes to save someone who cannot be saved. So Sayyidina Abu Ubaydah radiallahu anhu wrote back, saying to Amir al-Mu'mineen Umar ibn al-Khattab, politely declining and saying, I am but one of the Muslims. And I cannot avoid for myself what has befallen them. I wish to die with my fellow Muslims in suffering the plague. When Amir al-Mu'mineen Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu received the letter, he read it silently and he wept. He wept. And Umar radiyallahu anhu was a man not known to weep in that manner. He wept. Those around him said to him, has Abu Ubaydah passed away? Has he died? Sayyidina Umar radiyallahu anhu said, no, he hasn't died. وَكَأَنَّ قَدْ But to me it is as though he has already died. And he wept. That's how much he loved him. And how much he trusted him. And when Sayyidina Umar radiyallahu anhu first heard of the plague, he feared that he would be struck because he was actually travelling at the time towards Sham. And he feared that maybe he would be struck by the plague. And he didn't know of the position of Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah. So he said to those around him, he said, if And he meant that if he is struck by the plague, and if Abu Ubaidah is still alive, then I will appoint Abu Ubaidah as the Khalifa of the Muslims. And in one narration he said, I won't consult anyone. I will not consult anyone. And I will appoint Abu Ubaidah as the leader of the Muslims. And Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal rahmatullahi alayhi relates this hadith in his Musnad. He says that Sayyidina Umar radiyallahu anhu said, if Abu Ubaidah is still alive, and he meant that I'm about to leave, then I will appoint Abu Ubaidah as the leader of the Muslims. And on Yawmul Qiyamah, when Allah will ask me, why did you appoint Abu Ubaidah? I will say in reply to Allah, O Allah, I heard your Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say that every prophet has a trustee, and my trustee is Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. And in another narration he said, I will appoint him and I won't consult anyone. And if I am asked, my reply will be that I have appointed someone who is trusted by Allah and trusted by his messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Imagine his position. And Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu would have appointed him. And in the same narration, the long narration, there are actually two people that he mentions. He says, if Abu Ubaidah is alive, I will appoint him. And then he related this hadith that, and I will say to Allah that I appointed him because I heard your messenger say, every prophet, the wording is different. Here he says, every prophet has a trustee and my trustee is Abu Ubaidah. Then he said, if Abu Ubaidah is no longer alive and Mu'adh ibn Jabal is alive, then I will appoint Mu'adh ibn Jabal. And if I am asked, why did you appoint Mu'adh ibn Jabal? I will say, I appointed Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiyallahu anhu, for indeed I heard the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say, on the Day of Judgment, Mu'adh ibn Jabal will be resurrected in such a way that he will be placed in front of an assembly of ulama, and he will be so distant from them that he will be an arrow's throw away. Meaning, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said of Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiyallahu anhu that a'lamuhum bil halali wal harami Mu'adh ibn Jabal, the most learned of halal and haram, of the lawful and the unlawful, of the companions, is Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiyallahu anhu. He was a man of the Qur'an, a scholar of the Qur'an, a scholar of fiqh, of halal and haram. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam sent him as a qadi and as a judge and a teacher and a guide for the people of Yemen. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam loved him also. We know very little of the caliber of these companions. But Sayyidina Umar radiyallahu anhu said, if Abu Ubaidah is not alive, I will appoint Mu'adh ibn Jabal. He was an alim. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said to him, he will be resurrected on the Day of Judgment in such a way that he will be placed before an assembly of ulama. But not close to them. For the difference and the gap between him and the assembly of the ulama, i.e. of the ummah, will be a whole arrow's throw. That will be the distance. Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiyallahu anhu, he recognized Abu Ubaydah. Abu Ubaydah recognized Mu'adh ibn Jabal. Umar ibn al-Khattab recognized Abu Ubaydah and Mu'adh ibn Jabal. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu recognized Abu Ubaydah radiyallahu anhu. These companions understood each other. They knew each other. It takes an artist to recognize art. It takes a genius to recognize talent. It takes a wali of Allah to recognize a wali of Allah. It takes a scholar to recognize a scholar. If we fail to see the good and the great, the goodness and the greatness in others who are regarded as being good and great, then it's our failure. These Sahaba radiallahu anhum, they recognize each other. And even in their own time, they may not have been recognized as being such. In fact, speaking of Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu, during the siege of Damascus, which was being led by Abu Ubaydah ibn al Jarrah, during the siege of Damascus, under his command, someone was critical of Abu Ubaydah ibn al Jarrah. Maybe he was questioning his strategy and the failure of the Muslims to immediately conquer Damascus without the siege. And he made this criticism in front of Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu. And his suggestion was, he said, if Khalid ibn al-Walid was the commander, then the Muslims would not be in this position. Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu. This is what I said. It takes a person of that caliber to recognize someone of that caliber. Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu said to him, you criticize Abu Ubaidah? I swear by Allah, of all the people who remain on earth, he is the best. They were similar. They were similar. One Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu, he sent, like I said, I'll relate the story in a moment, but it takes great people to recognize greatness. And the companions saw this in each other. Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu was a beloved friend of Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah. Another one of their close friends was none other than Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu. He would say, أَخِلَّائِي مِنْ أَصْحَابِ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. He would say, my best friends. Allahu Akbar. Imagine this friendship. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud being who he was. Abdullah ibn Mas'ud says, radiyallahu anhu, my best friends amongst the companions of the Messenger of Allah are Abu Bakr, Umar, and Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah. The three who are the most beloved, the three who are the most deserving of khilafah and leadership, these three were the best friends of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. They recognized each other, even though others may have failed to recognize them. And what was it? We know of just some of the qualities of Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah. One, even though he was made a leader, and this is one of the greatest teachings of Islam, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in a very authentic hadith which I've related before, do not ask for leadership. For if you ask for leadership and you are given leadership, by aspiring to it and seeking it, then you will be abandoned to it, i.e. you will be left to your own devices with the burden of leadership, with all its responsibility and burden. But if you are given leadership without seeking it or aspiring to it, then you will be assisted in it, meaning Allah will assist you. And that was the truth. That was one thing about Abu Ubaydah radiallahu anhu. Aisha radiallahu, Umm al-Mu'mineen Aisha radiallahu anha says, if the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would have named a Khalifa after him, it would have been Abu Bakr, Umar, or Abu Ubaydah, and meaning in succession, Abu Ubaydah ibn al-Jarrah. Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu said, extend your hand, O Abu Ubaydah, so that I may pledge my allegiance to you
and appoint you as a leader of the Muslims. Sayyidina Abu Bakr radiyallahu anhu said to the congregation, O Muslims, I am content and pleased with one of these two as your leader, either Umar ibn al-Khattab or Abu Ubaidah. And during his lifetime, during the lifetime of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he would appoint Abu Ubaidah radiyallahu anhu as the commander of military expeditions and of large groups, large expeditions. So much so that on one occasion, but the lesson is, Abu Ubaidah radiyallahu anhu never sought leadership for himself. He never aspired to it. In fact, even when he was given it, he would relinquish it. His humility, his unworldliness. Once, Amr ibn al-As radiyallahu anhu was in the north near Sham during the time of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. He was in a very difficult position. He sent word to the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam for reinforcements. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam raised a small army. And in that army was Abu Bakr and Umar radiyallahu anhuma. And despite the presence of Abu Bakr and Umar, who did he appoint as leader and commander of that expedition? Abu Ubaydah ibn al Jarrah. Despite the presence of Abu Bakr and Umar radiyallahu anhuma in the army, that army went as reinforcements for Amr ibn al-As radiyallahu anhu. When they arrived, Amr ibn al-As radiyallahu anhu said to the arriving reinforcements, he said to them, I am your Amir and leader. I mean, they had to decide these were reinforcements. He said, you have only been sent as reinforcements, so I am your Amir. But the noble Muhajirun in the reinforcing expedition said to him, you are Amir of those who are with you. Our Amir is still Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. They refused to recognize anyone else as Amir in the presence of Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. Allahu Akbar. Abu Ubaidah radiyallahu anhu, with his humility, he said to Amr ibn al-As and he announced to the rest that I relinquish my leadership and I follow Amr ibn al-As. He was extremely humble. When Umar ibn al-Khattab radiyallahu anhu made him the supreme commander of all the Muslim forces in Sham and he relegated Khalid ibn al-Walid radiyallahu anhu, what was the response of Khalid ibn al-Walid? These were the noble companions. Khalid ibn al-Walid radiyallahu anhu, was he bitter? No. He stood up and addressing his army and his most loyal and devoted veterans, he said to them, Abu Ubaidah has been appointed commander over all of us. And indeed, we have heard the Messenger of Allah say, every ummah has a trustee and an ameen, and the ameen and trustee of this ummah is Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. So what did Abu Ubaidah radiyallahu anhu do? Khalid ibn al-Walid was gracious in his relegation. And he was gracious in his, and obedient in becoming one of the subjects of Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. And what was Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah's response to Khalid ibn al-Walid's speech? He stood up also and he said, O people, even though he was now commander, he said, O people, and indeed I have heard the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam say that Khalid ibn al-Walid is a sword of the swords of Allah. Wa ni'ma fatara ashira, and how great a young man of the clan is Khalid ibn al-Walid. The companions loved and respected each other in such a way. In fact, the first time Khalid ibn al-Walid radiyallahu anhu was dispatched as a reinforcement for Abu Ubaidah radiyallahu anhu in the siege of Damascus, Abu Ubaidah radiyallahu anhu actually said to him when he arrived, he said, O Khalid, you have come to strengthen me and to reinforce me here, leaders in prayer. Khalid ibn al-Walid radiyallahu anhu said, I can never stand before someone of whom the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that every ummah has a trustee and the trustee of this ummah is Abu Ubaidah ibn al-Jarrah. He refused to stand in front of him in prayer. That was their love and respect for each other, their humility. Let us learn from their humility. In fact, Abu Ubaydah radiallahu anhu was so humble and his gaze was on the Akhirah to such a degree that he would say, he actually made an announcement and he said, "O people, I am of the Quraysh," meaning he was a nobleman of the Quraysh. "I am of the Quraysh. But if I see anyone amongst you, black or red," red meaning brown, "black or brown amongst you, who excels me and exceeds me in taqwa, then I will follow in his footsteps." And he would say, "I wish I was a ram whose owners would then slaughter the ram, eat the meat, and drink the stock." Why would they make comments such as these? The reason Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu would say, he would see a bird and say, "I wish I was a bird, roaming and flying freely without a care in the world. I wish I was a blade of grass." Why would the Sahaba radiallahu anhu make such comments? The reason they would do so is that they feared accountability and standing before Allah on the day of reckoning. They would rather be a blade of grass, a bird, flying around carelessly, or even a ram that would be slaughtered, whose meat would be consumed and whose stock would be drunk, and over and done with. For they feared accountability and standing before Allah on the day of judgment. And Abu Ubaydah radiallahu anhu, he was appointed supreme commander of the forces of Sham that conquered that whole fertile and rich region. That was the land of Byzantine Rome, with all its glory, its opulence, its riches, its power, its glitz, its glamour. The Muslims occupied the palaces in Bosra, in Jerusalem, in Damascus, in Antioch, all the forts in that whole region, all the way up to Asia Minor and Anatolia. And yet, what could one assume? At the head and at the realm and in command of all of this, with overall control, was Abu Ubaydah. He would have enjoyed the riches, the power, the opulence. He would have settled into a comfortable life. He would have, like, if these companions had any remnant of the days of before, when the Arabs and the Bedouin of Arabia would raid and they would claim as much as they could for themselves. If there was any remnant of that, then Abu Ubaydah radiallahu anhu, being the overall commander and being in charge of all of this, with all these riches and this power, this influence at his disposal, at his feet, he would have claimed a share for himself. And yet, his asceticism, his unworldliness, his gaze on the Akhirah, all of these were such, they had no interest in the dunya whatsoever. Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu sent a number of gold sovereigns and a few thousand dirhams to Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu anhu. Its calculation in today's currency would be about £10,000. He sent that money, silver coins and gold sovereigns, to Abu Ubaidah. And he actually said to the messenger, "See what Abu Ubaidah does with this money." When Abu Ubaidah radiallahu anhu received the money in Sham, he immediately distributed it amongst the Muslims. Then he sent the same amount of money to Mu'adh ibn Jabal. What did Mu'adh ibn Jabal do? This is what I said earlier. They were all close to each other. They knew and recognized each other. Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu again distributed all the money amongst the Muslims. His wife said, "We were in great need, dire need, so we kept a bit just for our bare necessities." When Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu was told that the money was given to Abu Ubaidah, the money was given to Mu'adh ibn Jabal, and this is how they disposed of the money, Sayyidina Umar radiallahu anhu said, "Alhamdulillah, all praise be to that Allah who has created amongst Muslims such people who behave in such a way." They gave the money away, no interest whatsoever. And his asceticism was such, Allahu Akbar. And I'll end. Sayyidina Umar radiyallahu anhu, when he went to inspect the forces in Sham, when he arrived there, he said, "Where is my akhi, my brother Abu Ubaydah?" Abu Ubaydah came, the supreme commander. He came on a camel, pompous, resplendent. No, he came on a camel, and the reins of the camel were made from raw rope. The bridle and the reins, were raw rope. Sayyidina Umar radiyallahu anhu, Imam Abu Dawood rahmatullahi alayhi relates in his Sunan that Sayyidina Umar radiyallahu anhu said in front of everybody, on one occasion when they both met, Sayyidina Umar radiyallahu anhu, he met Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah, he shook his hands, and Sayyidina Umar ibn al-Khattab took the hands of Abu Ubaidah and kissed them. Umar radiyallahu anhu kissed the hands of Abu Ubaidah. Then he took him to one side. People were still watching, but they couldn't hear what they were saying. Abu Ubaidah and Umar ibn al-Khattab stood to one side, and they both began weeping. So Imam Abu Dawood rahmatullahi alayhi relates in his Sunan that when Sayyidina Umar radiyallahu anhu came to inspect the Muslim garrisons in Sham, he said to Abu Ubaidah in front of everybody, "Oh Abu Ubaidah, take me to your house. Take me home." Abu Ubaidah radiyallahu anhu said, "O Amirul Mu'mineen, you only wish to weep over me. مَا تُرِيدُ إِلَّا أَن تُعَسِّرَ عَيْنَيْكَ." The wording is beautiful. O Amir al-Mu'mineen, you only wish to squeeze your eyes' tears over me. تُعَسِّرَ عَيْنَيْكَ. You only wish to squeeze your eyes' tears over me. Sayyidina Umar radiyallahu anhu persisted, "Take me home." Why did Sayyidina Umar radiyallahu anhu go? Not because he wanted to inspect how the supreme commander was living. Maybe he is abusing the wealth. Maybe he is abusing the resources. Maybe he is falsely claiming and misappropriating the wealth of the Muslims. No, Sayyidina Umar radiyallahu anhu trusted him more than that. When he arrived, he said, "Where is my brother Abu Ubaidah? Abu Ubaidah, take me to your house. You only wish to weep over me, O Amir al-Mu'mineen." He persisted, "Take me to your house." When they arrived, Sayyidina Umar and Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah entered the house. Sayyidina Umar radiyallahu anhu looked around the house and he began weeping. He looked around the house and he said, "O Abu Ubaidah, I can only see a bedding, a plate, and a leather bag of water. O Abu Ubaidah, is there any food in your house?" Abu Ubaidah radiyallahu anhu went to a container and pulled out some qusayrat. The wording of the hadith in Abu Dawood's Sunan is qusayrat. Qusayrat means small broken pieces. And normally what this used to be used for is dry provisions. You know how we have bowls or containers of nuts, pistachios, almonds, walnuts, broken nuts. These things, small broken savouries, this is what you call maksurat or qusayrat in Arabic. So the wording of the hadith is, he went to a container and he pulled out some qusayrat, broken, crushed pieces of nuts, etc. And he presented them to Umar ibn al-Khattab. And who was this? The supreme commander of the Muslim forces in Sham, of Byzantine Rome. Sayyidina Umar radiyallahu anhu began weeping. Abu Ubaidah said to him, "O Amir al-Mu'mineen, didn't I tell you that you only wish to weep over me?" Then he said, "O Amir al-Mu'mineen, what you see before you, this is sufficient to carry me to the grave. This is sufficient to carry me to the grave." Sayyidina Umar said, "O Abu Ubaidah," whilst weeping, Umar ibn al-Khattab said to him, "O Abu Ubaidah, the dunya, the world, has touched every one of us except you, O Abu Ubaidah." Abu Ubaidah, this was long before the plague. When Abu Ubaidah radiyallahu anhu was struck by the plague, what had happened is that he was struck by the plague around him. But his desire, he did not wish for anything in the world. Even though he fought so many battles, he was never martyred. He was in every battle with the Messenger of Allah, but he was never martyred. And even then afterwards, he was never martyred. But was he a coward in any way? Far from it. Mu'adh, because they were very good friends, Mu'adh ibn Jabr and Abu Ubaydah, Mu'adh ibn Jabr radiallahu anhu was wounded. So he sent someone to Abu Ubaydah and said to him, go and tell Abu Ubaydah, we have been pierced with spears and we are wounded. How are you? So Abu Ubaydah radiallahu anhu, he showed his hand to the messenger. And there was a spear wound in the hand. So the messenger, when he saw the wound, he didn't think much of it. And the others also around him said, this is nothing, O Abu Ubaydah. So Abu Ubaydah radiallahu anhu, pointing to the wound in his palm, said to him, I will pray that Allah blesses it and increases it. I will pray that Allah blesses this wound and increases it. If I pray for its increase and its blessing, then inshallah it will increase. And when Muslims around him in the camp were contracting the illness and were afflicted by the plague, Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah was still safe. He actually raised his hands and prayed to Allah that, oh Allah, grant me and my family our share of the plague also. In fact, my apologies, I mixed up the wording. When he saw the wound, the person said to him that this is nothing, a very small wound. So of that wound, he said, it may be small, but I would not enjoy or accept a whole herd of red camels in lieu of this wound. And when he prayed to Allah, that, oh Allah, grant me, Abu Ubaidah, and my family our share of the plague, he was safe. No sooner had he made that dua than within a short time a boil broke out on his thumb. So then he would look at the boil and he would say to the boil, others said to him, that's nothing. And he would say, I pray that Allah blesses this boil and that it increases. And indeed it did increase. That's when he received the letter of Umar ibn al-Khattab radiallahu anhu, and he said that I wish to die with the Muslims. And I know what Amir al-Mu'mineen wants. He wants to save someone who cannot be saved. And he declined to go to Medina and to save himself. Allahu Akbar. In that garrison, there were 36,000 Muslims with Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu anhu. And in that plague, 30,000 perished. 30,000 died. Only 6,000 survived. One of them was Abu Ubaidah radiallahu anhu. And before he died, he appointed Mu'adh ibn Jabal as the overall commander and his successor. And in that same year, within a few months, Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiallahu anhu also passed away in the plague. I end with just one wise saying of Sayyidina Abu Ubaidah radiallahu anhu, in the hope that we can learn from his example. We can learn from and adopt his character of humility, of asceticism, of unworldliness, of the love of Allah and his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and of his piety. He was once walking through the Muslim camp, and obviously when in the camp at the time, there would be dirt on the floor, etc. In the camp. So he's walking through the camp and he said to his companions, there are many who try to whiten their clothes, yet they dirty and soil their faith and religion. And there are many who try to honour their soul, but in fact they are humiliating and degrading and disgracing their soul. O Muslims, hasten towards and beat your old sinful misdeeds with new fresh good deeds. These were his words. I pray that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable us to understand. May Allah make us amongst those who learn from the life and the character and the personality and the example of these noble companions radiyallahu anhum. May Allah give us a share of their love for Allah and his messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and a share of their nobility, their piety, their humility, their learning, their asceticism, their unworldliness, and their character. وَصَلَّى اللَّهُ وَسَلَّمْ عَلَىٰ عَبْدِهِ وَرَسُولِهِ نَبِيِّنَا مُحَمَّدْ وَعَلَىٰ آلِهِ وَصَحْبِهِ أَجْمَعِينَ سُبْحَانَكَ اللَّهُمَّ وَبِحَمْدِكَ نَشْهَدُ أَن لَا إِلَهَ إِلَّا أَنْتَ نَسْتَغْفِرُكَ وَنَتُوبُ إِلَيْكَ.